little introduction about our speakers today. So Sami Lanza Khan is a master's student at SAS here, studying post-colonial studies. She did her undergraduate degree in history at the University of Cambridge, and it was part of that degree that she researched and produced her undergraduate thesis that she'll be presenting on today. It was awarded the best dissertation in the Cambridge History Faculty, as well as across three other departments for that year. The experience of first both female migrants from Pakistan to West Yorkshire, 1960s.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming, everyone, and thanks so much for inviting me to this. It's really exciting. I'm just really excited actually to speak about it, like, it, at SOAS, because I feel like other people might have like a lot to add and kind of be able to tell me something that I don't know. So to start off with, I'm going to kind of contextualize the topic and then I'll just kind of go through the main question that will be guiding the talk. I think it's important to contextualize this because this is a time where, in Britain in particular, Pakistani Muslims in Britain are, especially women, are talked about so much in the media, from politicians, and always in negative terms, and rarely getting to kind of talk about themselves and represent themselves. To situate myself, so I'm a third generation Pakistani in this country, so my grandparents migrated in 1961 to Bradford, so I'm going to be focusing on West Yorkshire. I'll be focusing on Leeds and Bradford, two cities in north of England. I guess I wanted to focus on women in particular because from my own life experience, I knew that, like, my grandma, for example, was far more complex than the media would ever allow her to be. And I wanted to explore that really. In terms of female migrants, nobody has written a lot historically. From that time, there was like a lot of ethnographies, and you kind of get students from Leeds and Bradford universities are like going into the urban ghetto and, like, you know, finding out about these women. And they're filled with quite a lot of problematic assumptions. And most of the work that is done on migrants is from Pakistan is men, and then you get kind of, you'll just have like, and then their wives followed them. And on the other hand, like, a lot of the history about women in post-war Britain is about white women and not migrant women. So I was kind of wanting to, like, you know, deal with the fact that Pakistani women are marginalised in both of these histories. If I talk too fast, by the way, please someone tell me to slow down, because I will do that. So yeah, after contextualizing the whole thing, I will talk you through my dissertation findings. Basically, this was an interesting dissertation to do, particularly in the history faculty at Cambridge, because they kind of prioritized like, I would say, quite archival-based traditional histories, or at least like that, you know, that's kind of what history, I think, has been predominantly done there. And there wasn't a lot of archives about these women. These are women who didn't really produce a lot of material themselves that was archived, but also that what was written about them in the archives was not really about them. It would be about men as kind of problems to do with education, crime, but not women. So I did an oral history project. That was where I got most of my information about these women, and I'll talk more about that later. So the central question guiding today, guiding the dissertation, was to ask really why culture has been the predominant factor explaining and underlying migrant women's lives. So culture will be given as the explanation for why women had social interactions that they did, why they dressed as they did, their employment, what employment they participated in, their political views, everything kind of comes down to, in the literature, or just say, because of their cultural and religious views. No one, you know, we don't get to ask what that means, we don't get to contextualize it. So through my research, what I'm going to suggest today is that culture, you know, actually isn't very meaningful. And it's more important to look at the context of those lives and to also look at women's agency in that context. Okay, so to begin with, when and why did Pakistanis come to West Yorkshire? So in the 20th century, basically, you have four phases. In the 1930s, you get some Pakistanis coming through the merchant navy. So they're Indians at that time, this partition hasn't happened. The merchant navy, and then you get what's called chain migration. And this is after World War II. So after World War II, there's labour shortages, particularly in northern mill towns like Leeds and Bradford. And what chain migration is basically, say, I'm a man, I go from Pakistan to West Yorkshire, I work in a mill for a couple of years, and then I go back, and my brother or my son or my father, yeah, probably my brother or my son come, they work for a few years, they come. So it's this kind of like chain, it's we go and we come. And the jobs that they were doing here is mainly manufacturing and foundries. So what happens that is really pivotal is that in 1962, there's the Commonwealth Immigrants Act. Basically, this introduced a voucher system. So for someone to migrate, you have to have a voucher, which just means you have an employer that's vouchers that they will employ you. So to get that, obviously, you have to have someone else get it for you. And that's to say that basically this explains why you get settlement that happens in like kinship groups. So you get areas of Bradford and Leeds where everybody is from similar areas because someone had to get you the job from their employer. The other thing that this act did was make re-entry very difficult. So you now kind of will face the option of really coming to make your money, and then if you're going back, you're probably going back once and for all. And what that meant was that families kind of were faced with this difficulty of either we don't see our husband, our father for a long time, or we all go. So in the literature, they kind of say that the movement of temporary workers turned into permanent immigration of families. And it's ironic because it's state legislation that does this. And then obviously immigrants get blamed. So by 1967, 90% of immigrants were dependents. So that means they were their wives and children and parents. And that's why I chose 1960 to 1980 as my period of study. So in West Yorkshire, 0.6% of Yorkshire's 1971 population were Pakistanis. That's actually the biggest South Asian community. Doesn't look huge, but it was the biggest South Asian community. And the third biggest migrant community, the other ones being from Caribbean. They came to work, like I said, mills and foundries. And you can see here that there's definitely a lot more in Bradford than Leeds. But I think it's kind of important to note that the kind of distinction between Bradford and Leeds isn't that that great. So like people, their families would be kind of moving in between. You might go buy your meat in one city and get your news from the other city. You probably maybe travel even between to see people at the weekend. So I don't want to kind of like, they're not these two separate localities. And people very much think of them as joined, I would say. So where are these Pakistanis from? These statistics are taken from Bradford in 1964, but this is similar for Leeds in the sense that Azad Kashmir is the region from which the most Pakistanis are from. But all of these regions, what they have in common is that they are rural areas. And they all have the legacy of colonialism, which meant that land holdings kept producing, there was quite high unemployment. Also in these areas, you get direct advertising, so British industries, manufacturing, go directly to those areas after the war and say, we need people to come work in our industries, give come. But Azad Kashmir predominates because, so basically in 1961, this dam was built, Mangla Dam, and what that did was it displaced 100,000 people. So those people, submerging 250 villages. And so those people, a lot of them, migrated. It's important to note as well, regional identity is important, like the media and government kind of all refer to Pakistanis, but I think the way that people still think about their identities is quite provincial, quite regional, in terms of language, in terms of dialects, these things. This is just a map to kind of show that. So Azad Kashmir is up there. You have, so kind of on the left of Islamabad is Adda, and then you've got Jhelum, you've got Punjab here. And so that's the kind of area that people are coming from. That's just to kind of point out, it's not like all Pakistanis from all over. It's important that they have that background. Briefly as well, so the Oral History Project, I interviewed 10 women, 5 from Bradford, 5 from Leeds. They were all first generation. They all came between 1960 and 80. All married prior to migration. And the average age of migration was 19. I just kind of want to emphasize at this point, like, these women, because interviewing them was so, like, just forget the academic point of view. Like, it was like a real privilege for me, and it was really emotional. My grandma was one of the women I interviewed, and it was quite a personal project, basically. And I do just want to, like, emphasize throughout this that these women, a lot of them were 19, right? Like, this is very young. Like, Skype doesn't exist. Like, you're just going to this place. You don't speak the same language. I think it's important to just, like, humanize those experiences. And I used their interviews and their memories because, like I say, the archives weren't there. And it wasn't like a way to just recover the past directly, but a way to think about how the past had been meaningful to them and how they had remembered it and how that might disrupt the narratives that we are told about their experiences. So I'm going to now go through kind of 3 broad sections. One will be looking at wage work, then I'm going to look at like the family, and then politics. This is the biggest section, so bear with me. This is a little bit lengthy. So basically, I think there's a perception that Pakistani women were only ever housebound and therefore they didn't enter employment. So there's a couple of things to deconstruct there. One is that they were housebound, right? And we don't ask if that's true, and if it is true, why that might be. Two, the assumption that if they were at home, they were not employed, right? So it's actually the research I did will kind of trouble with those things. So first statistic, 20.7% Pakistani women were in the 1971 labor force in Britain. Now, the average of women was 50%, so it's quite a big difference, and this kind of discrepancy has been seen by a lot of scholars in the past, and they've assumed, they've said that the difference predominantly comes down to culture. So they've said it's unacceptable for cultural and religious reasons, that was the reason women didn't work. I should go back in a second, I think I just skipped a bit, but so when people say culture, what they also will talk about is horta, right? So this is the system of, I would say, gender organization that is one kind of ideal, right, in some of the regions that these women are coming from. And basically, the idea, I think we can, I'm going to generalize now because I'm then going to come back to it later, but the idea being kind of female seclusion, gender segregation to an extent, but like I say, predominantly an ideal, and I think we should see it as more of like a respectability discourse, because it's not something, you know, pragmatically, like, you have to have a certain amount of wealth, you have to have a certain amount of status to do that in the first place. You know, if you have to, work, and how you can't uphold these kind of gender things if you, yeah. So I'm going to come back to that, but that's basically what, when you read the literature, that explains this. People say, yeah, because women have to stay in the house, so they weren't working. But if we even just look a little bit closer at this number, whilst there are less Pakistani women in the workforce, those that are there are working more hours than white women. Now, I thought that was quite interesting, and I think it then also begs the question of how we understand that. In Pakistan, 78.9% of women were unpaid agricultural family labourers. So that's in 1960s, I think. I think we also need to think about that, right? So they're unpaid, so they're unwaged, because they're working for like a family unit, it's like a family economy. But they are working, right? And this is like outdoor labour, this is things like caring for domestic animals, preparing harvest, cutting fodder, and that kind of work. So, yeah, as well, there are women in the industry as well, so I think at that time it was like 6%, but you kind of have to understand in the 1960s, Pakistan manufacturing isn't like on a large scale, it's not like how we may be thinking about in like Bradford and Leeds mills. So, you know, 6% doesn't, I wouldn't take that as like a huge minority or something like that. And from my interviews, one woman, Arshad, she said that in her village, everybody did spinning, she did weaving. Another woman was a seamstress in Pakistan. So I just kind of want to trouble this idea that, you know, the way that Pakistanis were in Pakistan was just supplanted and brought to West Yorkshire, and that way they were was that women didn't work. So clearly, you know, this isn't actually true. And then this kind of comes to my kind of, I guess, like the most sort of provocative suggestion. I'd love to hear like what people think about this, but this is kind of what I suggested throughout my work, was that if we kind of understand, so coming back to this gender system is based very much on the premise of men's honour being protected, being secured through how women are sort of segregated or secluded, right? So when I explained this to a friend, I was like, it's very much like Downton Abbey, if you don't watch Downton Abbey, in the sense that how the woman acts, the girl, the daughter of the Duke, reflects on him really badly. Right, so I kind of want to emphasize as well, this is a respectability discourse that exists in different ways, in different places. But my suggestion is that if we understand it as linked to masculinity in this sense that men's honor is closely bound up with it, and we think about masculinity as certain actions, certain characteristics, certain things that people have to do to say that they are a man, then what I would suggest is that the way that you can kind of protect, seclude, or secure the space that your women, so your daughter, your wife, let's say, are in, is a way that you assert your masculinity. So, tell me if you're not following, this is a long-winded point. So if we suggest that is one of the ways that you mark your masculinity, let's say others might be like, what kind of occupation you have, what kind of house you have, how wealthy you are, those kind of things. My question is, what happens when Pakistani men come to a society where suddenly, A, they're racialized. They've never been racialized before in the same way, right? Because you're now in a society that's predominantly white. So you suddenly enter a new kind of hierarchy where you're not top of the chain, right? But secondly, in Bradford and Leeds in particular, The work the men were doing is, and this is a quote from a white man named Bradford at the time, he said that the work they were doing was the work that white men would not do because after the war it was seen as women's work. So these men are doing women's work, right? So there's also this other kind of sense of emasculation is my argument, and it's racialized as well. So my suggestion is that if we kind of see that they're losing this their status in this regard, in the kind of occupational realm, is there a way that maybe you would emphasize other status markers, right? So you might decide, okay, it's even more important than ever that I do make sure that my wife, my daughter, you know, doesn't actually dishonor me by leaving the house. This is a suggestion I have, and I'd love to hear what you guys think. But I think this defense of masculinity does come out in some quotes. So one woman referred, yeah, she said, my husband didn't agree to me working, he didn't like it. She expands, he said, women look after the house and men earn the money. And I think what's really interesting is to look at the second half of that. He says, men earn the money, right? It's very much defining his role. It's about what it means to be a man is to earn the money in this context. And so therefore, if she was to earn the money, that would destabilize the whole thing, right? That would be like, well, what does it mean for me to do then? And you know, how do I assert my identity? So I think that women working, you know, if we want to see it in we've got to see that it's not like just a continuity of what that means. So it wouldn't mean the same thing in Pakistan as it means here, but in this context, which as well you've got to remember is geographically different. You're not just living amongst people that you've known all your life that might be extended family. You're in a new context. You're living in like terraced housing in Bradford. And I think that's important to think about as well in terms of like, you know, who people can interact with and that kind of thing. So I would say that actually this kind of threat to masculinity is important in understanding women's working. But on the other hand, women did work, right? We've got this 20.7%. And these women that were working were doing, they were doing work even, and this came up in the interviews, even despite that they would say like, my husband didn't want me to work, but I did work. Or, you know, my husband, I think there's one woman who said, my husband didn't want me to work, but I told him it's too late, I've already started. And that kind of thing. So you kind of also have to remember, like, there's agency involved here. There's the fact, the actual just practicality of needing money, right? So a lot of migrants are also sending remittances home. They're sending money to people in Pakistan. But at the same time, they're trying to raise a family in Britain. So obviously, it's quite like a lot of economic pressure there, and people are working. Women are having to go to work. It's also important to note that there's like a time, we need to look at time. So in the 1960s, a lot fewer women were working than in the 1970s, by the end of the 1970s. And just a quote from a couple of women were that, you know, in 1960 it was very rare to work. By 1977, everybody was working, all the Pakistani community, girls, even older women. My grandma said that in 1960 all of her colleagues were white, but by the 1970s, there were more South Asians, and she actually made the point that after 1968 and 1970, when a lot of Asians were expelled from Uganda and Kenya, that a lot of those women would start working in the factories, and that perhaps made it more respectable for people to work. And I'd love to kind of know more about that. I didn't go into that in depth, but I, you know, wondered how much that has to do with class and caste respectability and those kind of things. If anybody knows, I'd love to hear what you have to say. But yeah, this is all just to say that women clearly were not straightforwardly housebound, you know, and I think it's actually important to address the 79%, you know, the other side of that 20%, the women not in employment statistics, right? Actually, a lot of informal labour, a lot of unorganised labour wouldn't get accounted for in this statistic. While a lot of men did manufacturing, a lot of women in Bradford and Leeds at that time, migrant women in particular, this isn't just Pakistani, were doing homeworking. And what that is it's called piecework, and what you do is a factory basically outsources their labour. So they would say, can you can sew, say you sew like a collar or a sleeve, you sew as many of them as you can, if you have time for, you sell them to the factory, and it means the factory don't have to pay for, you know, renting premises, they don't have to do health and safety, they don't have to give you contracts, they can exploit you basically, they can exploit your labour. And your labour wouldn't be accounted for in these statistics. So a lot of the women that I interviewed did homeworking, but also some of them just kind of bought sewing machines and sewed clothes for other Pakistani women, sold them to those women. So we've got kind of entrepreneurial stuff going on as well. Women who did homeworking also, most of the ones that I interviewed anyway, did it alongside another job. In this case, a lot of factory shifts. So factory work, three of the women I interviewed someone who worked in a textiles mill, one in a television factory, television making, I guess, and one in a teddy bear making factory. I'm not sure if that's what I thought it was. But then, yeah, really interestingly, so retail I put there. So five out of the seven women who told me that they had ever worked, worked in retail. Now, these were generally family businesses, and they were generally like part of the house, so maybe like the downstairs, the front of the house, that kind of thing. And that's in line with the statistics at the time that say that 53% of Asian businesses in Bradford employ their wives. Now, I actually think it's important to kind of question this employment thing. I wonder how much women weren't selling their labor, basically, in this job. They were selling goods for the family economy. Again, it's for the family unit. And I would suggest that maybe this is tied up to that respectability question, and that actually because you're not selling your labor, you're not earning money, you're just doing it as like, you know, you're just selling stuff from the family shop. There's a way that that's kind of not transgressing that line between masculinity, breadwinning, and women being in the home. And even physically, because these shops were part of the home, women who worked at the shop said to me, so one woman, she did home working and she ran the shop, her husband wasn't even there, but she ran the shop, and she said, I did a lot of work, but not outside of home. And that kind of disclaimer being very much like, don't worry about it, wasn't outside of home. So I think that's something to really think about. But on top of just like respectability and any of that, women, you've got to think like, why were they working at home, right? Because at home, you can also look after your children. You can also do the unpaid labor that is expected of you. You can clean, you can cook, get all of that done whilst kind of selling some things, making a bit of money. And when you look at the childcare cost in Bradford and Leeds at that time, I can't remember the exact cost now, but it was something like to leave your child in childcare for 1 hour would be the equivalent of like a week's wages. So obviously it's like unfeasible. It's unfeasible for women to do. And I did actually come across a race relations report which said that, you know, empirically there was evidence of prejudice amongst childcare providers. So are you going to feel comfortable leaving your child at a place that you don't know how they're going to treat your child because of your race? In terms of race, discrimination, right? So this is the National All Sorts Society. Asian women are the most exploited section of the working class. So this is obviously because they're women, they're racialized women, they're migrant women, they're women who a lot of them don't speak English as a first language, they don't have previous skills in sort of in like manufacturing, they could be paid less, and they have a lack of access to information. A lot of times it wasn't just employers who were racist or kind of discriminatory, it was also unions. You have a lot of cases where unions won't actually back Asian employees, and particularly female Asian employees. There's a really famous Imperial typewriter strike. If you don't know about it, look it up, it's quite cool. And that was a case where Asian women had to go on strike despite their union not backing them. And it's very much a racial thing. And actually something that one of the interviewees told me was that when she started at the factory she was working in, there was predominantly the other women were Jamaican women working there, and they said from the start, look, every week when you get your wage slip, show it to us and we'll all make sure we're getting the same. And I think that's important to note. The union isn't doing its job really for these women, and they're providing their own kind of, they're doing their own unions, right? They're like providing their own support systems. So that was quite cool, I thought. Interestingly, in terms of, so I asked women, and I think it's interesting to think about how I'm thinking about this and how they're thinking about it. I asked, did you ever feel you faced discrimination at work because of your race or your racial discrimination? And 6 out of 7 of those who work said no to that question. So at first, like, I was really surprised. I was like, what? Like, how can that be? I was so sure. But on the other hand, what I kind of realized through then, you know, continuing the conversation was that I think because in a context where discrimination is so commonplace, you don't sort of notice it in the way that I think when I'm thinking about the context I live in, I have language and words to call things what they are. So, and the reason that's kind of my conclusion is because they said no, but on the other hand, when they told me about the work they did, it was very frequent and recurrent for them to tell me, yeah, my employer was very rude to me, there was frequent use of the word packy in the workplace, especially from customers. And I also think a lot of women preempted discrimination, so this is kind of my analysis of them saying things like, when I went to a job interview, I would make sure not to wear salwar kameez, like traditional Pakistani dress, in case it didn't seem good. And I think, you know, if we kind of think about what might not seem good is that you're kind of giving away, that you're not what they want you to be potentially. And I think, to me, that indicates there is a recognition that you would be discriminated against if you were to dress in your sort of clothes. Also just things like women who worked in the shops kept knives under their tills, bats under their tills, did use them, did have to use them in self-defense. And so I think, you know, on the one hand it's like, no, but on the other hand, like, this seems to be really commonplace, like, racism. It's just, like, very everyday. It's very much a part of the work that you do. But also, I think it's important to think that at that time, what women's priorities were. So what I mean here is that, for instance, this was, my grandma in particular, was saying how, when I asked her about, like, you know, how people treated her because of working, she was much less preoccupied with how white employers or co-workers were treating her, and much more preoccupied with how other Pakistanis thought about her working. And so she had this story about how when she walked to work, there would be this one woman who would come out of her house and say, where are you going? Are you going to clean toilets? And it was very much like mocking, derisive. I think there's also some sort of like caste implications there, some sort of like, you know, it's unrespectable work wherever you're going. And my grandma kind of said, at that time, there were no Pakistanis working. At that time, I didn't even dare to mention the word work. I was so ashamed about it. So I think you kind of also remember that they've got other, there's other things going on there that, you know, potentially it doesn't matter so much. When racism is a kind of what you expect from the situation you're in, you have to remember that these women would also say things like, when I asked about, like, you know, do you think yourself as British or Pakistani, they would be still, some of them would be like, you know, yeah, I'm Pakistani because, like, you know, at the end of the day, we came here, this is their country, that kind of rhetoric. And I think it's in that context then that you've got to understand, like, how they're reading discrimination. Because if you feel like you're a migrant to this country, that you don't necessarily have to be treated a certain way, I think there's other things going on there. So just to complete this bit, I don't know what time I'm on. I think it's just important to remember that we think about wage work as inherently emancipatory a lot of time, and obviously, in this case, it entered women into all these new, like, racialized, gendered hierarchies. On the other hand, some of the women did kind of get a boost in confidence and the autonomy that having an independent wage gave some of them. So actually, one woman, this is very unique, I think, Arshad, she was actually able to finally divorce her husband because she had her own wage. And it was like very much because of that she was able to do it. Another woman actually managed to invest in her own land in Pakistan because her husband wouldn't agree to doing it. It was out of fear of repatriation, and she did. So, you know, there is autonomy, but it's autonomy within existing power paradigms. And it involves entering new power paradigms too. So I'll move on now to family and the home. So, I mean, these are just sections that, yeah, they're not necessarily as distinct as I'm making them out to be. So there's previously been this idea, don't worry about that in a second, I'll explain. There's been an idea that Pakistani families were kind of transplanted from Pakistan to West Yorkshire. I think there was one article that I read which was like, Mirpuri villages in Bradford. And it's like this idea that, yeah, the whole village comes, everything's the same, nothing changes. But in the reality, like, migration is disruption. Like, home is disrupted, family is disrupted. And I think also, like, let's remember that entering a context where there's other ideas about family, about marriage, about motherhood, there's other discourses. So first thing is, like, just physically, this map is from one of the books that I read this bit, I think was written in the 1970s. And what it's trying to explain is that the understanding of, like, household and family in Pakistan, this is India here, is a lot bigger. So here, say you've got, like, two parents, and then you've got their sons, and then women marry into the house, so you move into the house, and then they might have their own children. But as you can see, there's multiple couples within the house. That's kind of what I think is important to take from this. And then you relate to extended family, to in-laws. But in the UK, say only one son goes, and his wife and their children. You can see automatically, like, it's a lot of a smaller unit. And I think that's important just to realize. But also, men, when they first came, were mainly living, well, they're Bradford and Leeds, they were living in, like, dormitories, so it was just, like, trying to save as much money as you can. So you maybe get, like, 12 men in one dormitory, all in bunk beds. But as soon as, like, families started coming, people would move out into homes, into houses. And interestingly, like, the statistics show that Pakistani migrants were much more likely to go into home ownership than to rent. And because of that, they ended up in quite small, inner-city, terraced housing. And I think, again, that meant the emphasis was on this nuclear kind of unit, at first at least, and it's important to think about the kind of temporal change here, because as time goes on, as you earn more money, you are able, and this happens, like, to buy, let's say, the house next door, and then your brother and his wife move in, or you're able to buy a bigger house. But I do want to focus on the earlier period, because I don't think this is something that many people have looked at, and in particular I want to look at how people were maybe thinking about marriage. So this wasn't an interviewee that I had, but this was from the Bradford Heritage Project. So this woman said, when I came here to join my husband in the early 1960s, we spent a lot of time together. We went to the cinema to see films, we went to the park and for walks. As more people came to Bradford from Pakistan, we went back to traditional ways, and I stayed at home or with other women. Now, I think that's really important, because the suggestion here is that the association of emphasis on married life is with a time when there were fewer migrants. And to me, that suggests that there was something unconventional, almost, about performing married life and married partnership in that way. So some of the women I interviewed as well talked about Zojan. One woman, she said that her husband would take her to the cinema, just the two of them, against, even though, what did she say, yeah, despite the rest of the family said that this was a really bad thing. So I just want to kind of think about how, potentially in the early 1960s, there's something going on, and what I think it might be is that, so there's a sociologist, Mohammed Anwar, and he wrote in the 1970s, I think, about the myth of return, and this is about Pakistani migrants in particular, that a lot of migrants at that time believed that they would return to Pakistan. But this kind of became a myth with time, with the kind of recognition that it's unlikely because my children are growing up here, you know, for practical reasons, we're probably not. But the idea that you're going to return, kind of meaning that what you do here doesn't necessarily count in a full way. For a short period of time, what you do there could be unconventional. But then as more migrants come, as this woman indicates, even though this is an example to think about forward and backwards, I think we need to question that language, but it's interesting that she herself perceives that there's a period of change followed by going back to Pakistani norms. And I think that's something to think about, that it's not just like this one thing, all people come, everything's the same from staying up till, you know, 1960 to 80. So I'll just speed up a little bit. But yeah, I want to talk as well about how in the home, women were also doing labour, right? It's unwaged labour, but they're doing it. And this isn't like unique to Pakistani women in particular, but I think what is unique is that a lot of these women, from their accounts, came from kind of households and families where, because you weren't the only woman in the household, there's a lot of people that you're sharing unwaged responsibilities with. So there might be multiple people cooking at one time, multiple people cleaning. And also it wasn't kind of in the same way here, it wasn't that unrealistic that you might have other people and not family helping in the house. So like maids, or like, I don't know, someone was like, oh, well, it wasn't really a maid, it was just a girl from the village would help out. So I think, you know, there's like other people in the household helping. So I think women did face an increased double burden, and this is one quote from a woman, just to give you an example of like what life is like. You take the children to school, then you come back and get ready, then go to work in the shop, then after 4 or 5 hours of being there, it's time to pick the children up from school. You bring them home, feed them, take them to mosque, then go again to close the shop, then do the shopping, then come home and cook the family up to 7 o'clock. And other women told me, like, you know, you would cook the evening meal before going to work, so then the dinner is made. And I think, yeah, it's important to kind of note that working class women in general would be facing a double burden like this. But there are additional things, like what I said about childcare and the racial prejudice amongst providers. And I think also we've got to think about things like the language barrier and being able to exploit these women in a different way. So there was one woman, Rashad, who told me that her employer said to her, don't worry, if you can't find somewhere to leave your children, just bring them to the factory and they can work too. Which I thought was sounded very dodgy. And they did, they helped her, and you know, nobody questioned it. So I think, you know, there are probably things like that to think about how was that actually used against women. And as well, it's important to think about the fact that women didn't necessarily kind of feel that this was an imposition, but also that it was a way that defined their roles as women and their kind of resilience as women. So one woman said, for instance, like, we don't take help from men. And I think that it's interesting to think about how domesticity is thought about in this context, because at the same time, in post-war British literature, there's the idea that like there's this post-war domesticity, and it's very much about like, you know, returning from the war and like focusing on the home. And Pakistani migrants wouldn't be included in that really, because they're migrants, it's not really perceived as the same. And yet the way they think about it is similar in terms of like pride in the home and in domestic labour. But what is interesting is that whilst they thought that, the actual literature about domesticity very much excludes Pakistanis, but very explicitly. So there's a whole thing about Pakistani women being inadequate mothers. So educational, psychological, and sociological literature that I found in like local council records, this kind of thing, would talk a lot about how Pakistani mothers needed educating as mothers. They needed, there was classes that were put on for like baby care, teaching them about hygiene, about pregnancy care, about health. I think the hygiene one in particular like highlights that there are assumptions, there are racialized assumptions about these people that are informing the kind of classes put on. And then my favorite one was, this is from the Telegraph and Argus, is a local newspaper, and they were put on classes for Pakistani women in a school. They said the women were learning to make scones, pasties, and other English delicacies. They're a long way from being typically English housewives, but they've taken the first step. And I think, like, yeah. It says it in itself. It's like it's a bizarrely celebratory. It's very patronizing, and I think it shows there is this racialized understanding of motherhood that like white British women know how to do it. They do it best, and you know actually Pakistani women become this foil, particularly in Leeds and Bradford and in that literature. Briefly, I would just talk about as well like women's sociability. So like a lot of them were very lonely when they first came. Like that's a big part of their narratives, and that makes sense. But they say that it got better as time moved on, and I think there's a way in which they kind of reproduced the family, kind of family communities they would have had. So you have women being like, the first time I saw another woman, you know, who was Asian, I like ran over to her and said, where do you live? What house number? Like, how can I find you? And there's a real desire to, you know, reform these friendships. And then actually these women help out each other with chores, with childcare, with cooking. I think it's interesting to think about as well, you know, how then you create your own childcare units, you create your own communities where you can trust and do certain things. Briefly, I'll say something about religion, just because particularly now that's what Pakistanis are associated with. I'm not actually sure that Islam was predominant in these women's experiences at this time. What it mainly came out through in their kind of interviews was as part of their cultural identity. So it was something that they mentioned usually when I would talk about their children, what their worries for their children were. So they would say things like, I'm worried that my child will, in the UK, will lose their religion alongside language and culture. And I think that's important to realize, like the way that we're thinking about like Islam now in such a heavily politicized environment is completely different to the 60s, for example. And also, I just want to show you this example. So this is a Urdu language newspaper that was in Bradford, and this is 1978. The front page article says, the new generation is becoming rapidly more rebellious. Girls are taking loans to go to the pub, to smoke, and to roam around. They let their hair loose and apply lipstick and powder as soon as they get to school, but act innocent again when going home in the evening. So rather than actually suggesting that this is something novel to Pakistanis, though, what I want to suggest is that at this same era, like end of the 70s, start of the 80s, there's this whole discourse in Britain in general about permissiveness and about the idea that our youth, young people are just becoming like sexually promiscuous, they're just like going out all the time, we can't control them. And actually in Leeds in the late 70s, there was a conference I saw notes from, and it was the Christian and Muslim communities have a conference about our young people. And it's like, it's very much like a joint kind of worry. And so, you know, this is again one of those things where I'd like to suggest that this isn't, you know, actually this isn't a unique thing about Pakistanis. On the other hand, there is a unique thing, which was in Bradford I found some papers from an organisation that called itself the Muslim Parents Association, founded in 1973. So it was actually just two dads. they wrote a lot, and they made a lot of noise, and they basically called for Muslim children to not have to do the following: let no Muslim child attend assemblies or prayers, not be given RE lessons, religious education, and not be forced to take swimming lessons. All activities leading to immoral behaviour and exposure of bodies of our children must cease. Muslim girls must wear loops, tracksuits. Halal meat must be supplied to our children taking school dinners. It's actually interesting because at that time, children, it wasn't compulsory to go to assemblies in state schools. You were actually allowed to take your child out. And the rest of the things are interesting because the council, you kind of see the relation with the council. The council are very much taking it seriously. And, you know, I think it's kind of different to today where, because it's like a Muslim parents association, it would be kind of like, no, this is absolutely absurd. And it was much more of the kind of multiculturalist kind of, you see coming from the council being like, yeah, you know, we must provide the army, of course, that we must provide these things. We must find a way to have a dialogue with these parents. So I found that really interesting. And all in all from this section, I would just say that, you know, experience of the family did change through migration is my main point. There isn't just this transplantation of culture, and even if some norms did continue, it didn't happen immediately. And women did share experiences with a lot of working class women in general, but as migrants, their ideas about home and desire to pass on culture were unique. So this is my final section. I think I've got about 10, 15 minutes. This bit isn't as long, but it is really interesting because I think migrants, firstly, but then Pakistani women in particular, I mean, female migrants, kind of got completely excluded from, you know, the idea that they could be involved in politics or relevant to politics at all. Especially between 1960 and 80, because you do have in the 1980s, like, Asian youth movements, and I think because you kind of have the second generation, who, let's say, you know, English is their first language, and there's kind of more overt mobilization and political activity, people focus on that. But prior to that, you don't really get much. So I wanted to talk about, first I want to talk about party politics, because past work has actually recognized that Pakistanis got involved in the electoral political system faster than other migrant groups. And I think partly, you know, maybe this is due also to like settlement patterns in Bradford and Leeds in particular, because of their numbers, you know, there are certain constituencies and particularly council wards where it became really important to mobilize the Pakistani vote. Also, Pakistanis became a political problem in of themselves. So in 1968, Enoch Powell made his famous Rivers of Blood speech, so it's very anti-immigration rhetoric. And in the Bradford newspaper, the Telegraph in August, it showed that 67% of people agreed with Mr. Powell from the letters that were sent in, 30% disagreed, and 3 were doubtful, 3%. So, you know, again, I think that shows that this, you know, they were political, kind of like they were a political issue themselves. And the woman that I interviewed kind of remembered, you know, Powell as they said that he created a lot of difficulties, he wanted to get rid of Pakistanis. And there was a definite fear of repatriation at that time. There was memory of National Front riots, so the National Front was a far-right group in the 70s, and there was a big rally in Bradford in 1976, and there was an anti-rally as well. There was like a lot of violence and clashing, and when I asked women, they predominantly remembered that rally as like, we were worried about our children, we thought there would be a lot of violence. So this is interesting now. In terms of voting, I just wanted to talk a little bit about this advert I found here on the left-hand side. This was in the 1979 edition of the Ravi, the Urdu language newspaper. It's actually a direct translation of this advertisement, right? So this is a Conservative Party advertisement in 1979. So, you know, why should you support Labour? And it's kind of things that you would expect. It's like, Conservatives don't, you know, they'll tackle crime, the economy will get going again, they'll support small businesses. So that's interesting in itself, but when we then compare it, to the Labour Party advertisement, this advertisement is actually much more tailored to the migrant community. So there isn't, and I checked, there is no English language exact copy of this, I've written the Conservative one, and this one says things like it would reconsider the 1971 immigration regulations, it would propose swift entry for wives and children of men settled here. And I think that's really interesting, and it's similar to, in 1980 there's a famous advert, it's a picture of a black man, and it's a Conservative advert, and it says, Labour call him black, Tories call him British, that's right, yeah? And so there's very much about the idea that Tories are trying to create this cohesive, like, you know, we don't recognise race, we don't see colour, don't worry. Whereas Labour are like, no, we very much recognise you have deliberate and kind of specific needs. And I think in Bradford and Leeds that paid off. Labour, you know, had a lot of seats there. And the women that I interviewed, and then this is where it comes in that actually women are very politically active. So since they'd arrived, all of them had voted, 10 out of 10. 7 out of 10 had voted Labour, always. 2 had voted Change of Lee, and 1 did not dispose. The reasons for voting Labour included things like this, one being they called us over, so it's interesting. And a lot of people kind of, when I said like who was that, it would be like someone Wilson, Harold Wilson, maybe. So there's definitely like this memory of Labour is like on our side. Other people said Labour are good for Asian people. And I think that whole thing is interesting because it suggests that these women saw themselves as the migrant target group that this advert, for instance, appeals to. And it's interesting because at that time, there's more specific targeting to women as a constituency in the UK. But clearly, I think the fact that Pakistani women voted on this kind of basis proves that, you know, there aren't women's issues and migrant issues at elections. Like, all issues are racialized and gendered, and people are going to vote for what matters to them. And I just think that the case of Pakistani women really highlights that. It's also interesting to think about that Pakistani politics actually had a really big impact in Bradford and Leeds as well. So you have really interesting cases. This is in council elections in particular. So in 1973, two independents, Pakistanis, they ran as independents in one of the wards, and they opposed each other solely on the basis of Kashmiri independence. So one of the men had fought the Indians in Kashmir, and the other one, and he questioned the loyalty of the other man to Pakistan. So it's like this very, like, it's playing out in Bradford, this Pakistani kind of thing. And in 1974, there's a big swing from Labour to the Tories, because the local candidate aligned with India aligned against Bangladeshi independence. So they aligned, let me rephrase that. They swung to the Tories because he supported Pakistan against Bangladeshi independence. So there was this big swing, because they were all solely based on like what's going on in South Asia at that time. I will wrap up, I guess, now, but briefly, so non-party politics, there's a lot going on. Commission for Racial Equality, Community Relations Council. I mean, in most of these, Pakistani women aren't represented like in decision making. They are talked about, like I say, it's mainly like they need classes, they need educating, blah, blah, blah. There is one organisation that is Pakistani, and then there's a branch set up in the UK, which is called All Pakistani Women's Association. But it's, I mean, you know, it's predominantly middle class educated women, but they are Pakistani, and they, I found a letter actually in the National Archives that they sent to the Community Relations Council saying, look, we believe that you need more representation from people like us on your boards. And, you know, that's just to say that women also wanted representation, right? They were politically engaged. Just trying to decide what's more interesting. So, so in the 80s you have Asian youth movements, it's interesting as well because these are predominantly, they're quite masculine spaces and they're quite exclusive. And so then you do get like specific associations set up, like the Organisation for Women of Asian National Consent and AWAS. And they, it is interesting because the issues they deal with, so for instance, they deal with, they're one of the few organisations who look at the fact that, I think in the 70s or 80s, Asian women I think it was 80 Asian women who were stopped at borders and they were given like gynecological examinations forcefully. And so it's a very like racialized, very misogynistic, very problematic thing that's going on there. But none of the sort of like the main like race related groups did much about this. So it's kind of like just showing that women were kind of sidelined from that, but they were also sidelined from the women's liberation movement, right? So this is also kind of going on at the same time. And I'll just talk about this as my final thing, which I think is really interesting. So the National Women's Citizens Association is a, well, women's association. It's, you know, kind of like, it's a feminist organization at the time. So they hold this annual general meeting in 1967, and the topic of the meeting is migrant women having a war, their problems. So there are no migrant women actually invited, non-present at the meeting, and it's held at Harewood House, which is like a big manor in Leeds. It's the list of attendants, the like people attended it were like viscountesses, duchesses, this kind of thing. I think that kind of already points to the elite nature of this kind of organisation. But then I found like some handwritten notes from the meeting, and so the kind of solutions that they found to migrant women's problems were that their standards of behaviour and hygiene were different from, and so it seemed, lower than our own. And the solution was then to educate these women to British standards and freedom. So, as you can see, it's very paternalistic, very patronising, very much based on like colonial and racially informed assumptions about these women, no account of women's own experiences, and based on presumptions of illiteracy, of like, you know, lack of education and inferiority. Instead, hopefully I've shown, you know, Pakistani women actually, if they didn't go to something like this, was because they're busy with wage and non-wage responsibilities, they're excluded on gendered, racial and class lines. So my main point in this section really is that I hopefully made it clear that Pakistani women were politically involved by nature and they were engaged, but the first generation were perhaps less able to be involved than the second generation, not because of apathy or absence, but because of multiple barriers to participation and hindrances, including cost, childcare, language, social capital, and labour. And I think wider literature really needs to account for that, which it doesn't. So to conclude, I just want to wrap up. This research is basically just aimed to recover the complex and contradictory lives of such women. This picture is actually from one of the Asian youth center, youth elderly women's centres that I went to interview women. But yeah, their experiences cannot just be reduced to footnote of migrant men. They've too often been deemed the outcome of culture, cultural constraints, and hopefully that's something that I've displaced a little bit today through focusing on context and women's own oral histories and their kind of agency, which tells us how being women, being migrants, and being racialized and working class mothers meant that they faced specific exclusions. I've also hopefully highlighted that Islam is more of kind of a moral discourse, and that opens questions really about further research that could be done. And I've tried to show as well that time was really important, so like things weren't static between 1960 and 80, there was change. And I really think that's something to think about, and even think about now, because I think there's still a discourse that like the migrants who came in the 60s are the same, you know, they're the same, their children are the same, like, there's been no change, there's been no integration, there's been nothing happening. And you know, obviously there was a change immediately in 1960. But yeah, Pakistani migrant women were more consumed by everyday realities and practicalities than any brand narrative, in my opinion. They worked if they needed the money. Whether they worked depended on childcare and ISIF considerations. They sought out non-familial friends if they needed them, but they were more concerned about children and status than everyday racism. And I want to give these women their place in history, really, and allow them to be contradictory. I just want to end basically by saying, I'm just going to read the start bit of my acknowledgements page of my dissertation. I just want to read that to end. But yeah, thank you so much. And as soon as I've done that, floor is open to questions. So this is the beginning. I begin by thanking my nanny. Growing up, seeing her poise, bravery, fierce intelligence, wit and fearlessness inspired me to write this dissertation. It inspired me to write for a generation of women who now hobble along grey northern streets in their Salwar-kameezes and are so often passed by, ignored, erased, and silenced, so you'd never know what they've gone through to be here. This dissertation is a tribute to them, every single one of them. Thank you. Space. And I think actually the distinction that you've drawn between kind of like maybe that they were empowered in terms of their extended family is also, I think, you know, all these things need nuancing, but I think actually from the kind of evidence that I got, there's this kind of, some men can send remittances and can afford to, but actually the pressure of trying to send remittances home and raise a family here caused a lot of problems for a lot of men. And I actually think you do get cases where there are men who like refuse to go home for say 17 years because of the shame of being going home without being able to give everybody like £100 or without being able to kind of show my status has improved. And in fact, there's a really interesting book called Here to Stay, and it's just pictures from Bradford, but this photographer, so he had a photography studio, and he would take pictures of Pakistani families, and he said that what would happen is, so a family would come in, and they're relatively poor, not that well off, but he had lots of props in his office, including like watches, like nice shoes, briefcases, and the men would like all like, you know, get all these things, he'd take a picture, and then you'd send that home to Pakistan. So you're showing, yeah, my status, yeah, everything's spot on, like living at large. And I think actually that also points to that there is this kind of defensive, there is this threat. I think you're right, like I didn't draw the distinction as kind of straightforward as that, but they're just like, they're emasculated, they enforce for that. And like I say, they couldn't actually do that. A lot of cases, women were just like, sorry, mate, like I've got to work, you're not making enough money on your own. And in a lot of cases, actually, women were earning more than men because they were able to do piecework and other things. But yeah, I think, you know, I think class is a question, occupation is a question, but in Bradford in particular, like, these men were doing, like, night shifts, they were doing really quite, like, grueling labour, and I don't know is the answer, like, my kind of, is a hypothesis that, like, I'm suggesting that maybe because they lose this one marker of masculinity.
I mean, is it okay if I
come
up?
Sorry? Yes.
So I guess my observation was just based on anecdotes within my own extended family, and uncles and aunties who had really high status jobs in Pakistan. They then come over, they're not allowed to be doctors or engineers here, but they work at the very bottom. But then when they talk about themselves, you know, I expect them perhaps just to feel like they were completely shut to their dignity, but they talk about working in the corner shops, sending money home, helping their family in Pakistan to have better education and all the rest. I guess the problem here is anecdote, sample size, it's very hard
No, I don't think that's necessarily...
Well, for me, when I'm trying to articulate this, that's the problem.
But I think something interesting about that is that oral narratives are very much performances of the self. It's very much... And I think when I was doing those interviews, you know, we all recognise I'm from this community as well, like I all know certain insider things. And people were trying to present a certain story about themselves, which is a success story. You don't want to tell a sad story, you want to tell a story that I made it from the bottom. And so yeah, I think we kind of have to think about context even more because of those narratives. But yeah, that's pretty interesting to me.
You sort of, these women talked a little bit about some, I suppose, self-censorship from within the community of other Pakistani Muslims.
Right.
And how much of that do you think that they talked about passing on to their children? Because like I'm from a similar background. My grandparents came over, they lived in Leeds, my mom was born in 1962. But like, you know, they told her, you can't be a nurse because you'll be going out and working around strange men. So she became a nursery school teacher because that's the sort of safe occupation that the community didn't say anything about, but still we need the money so we have to do it. And you know, my another auntie getting a divorce, and you know, my grandmother being very ashamed of her daughter being the first woman in the community to divorce. How much of that do you think they sort of took with them?
I think it's more a question of like we have to treat those discourses of like shame and honour very seriously. Like you say, they shape the decisions that people are going to make. But I think, so when you kind of say like how much did they carry through to their children, I think it's, how I see it is like that it's less of a, I would say it's less of like a conscious perpetration, right? But the fact that, and I think it does come down to just even practical things like settlement patterns. So if you move to somewhere like Bradford and everyone is living as neighbours and everybody's kind of around, like that woman kind of indicated, who said that, you know, at first there's barely anyone here, we just, you know, we're having, you know, going to the cinema or whatever, and then people came. And I think it's about norms, and it's about this idea that we all came from this place and you should know the norms, and if I have to follow the norms, you have to follow them too. I mean, I'm not the expert, and I don't want to kind of perpetrate some sort of like essentialist generalization, but I think, like I'm kind of trying to, what I'm trying to suggest is that this is like, it's not unique, right? That these are respectability discourses, and they act in a specific way for women in this place, this whatever. But I don't know. I'm not really answering this coherently, so I'm trying to think about like what is actually going on there. I think if you think about things like class as well, like maybe place of class, so that when there have been cases of, you know, people moving up into a middle class job, let's say, or moving out, like, so I know people who moved out of Brandon Leeds, let's say, and if you move, let's say, to a more suburban, white area, where other people who know what norms you might need to follow aren't there, you don't have to follow those norms anymore. I don't know though, I'd love to hear if other people have kind of thoughts about that, because I'm not entirely sure. But yeah, so one example actually that I did ask them explicitly was, you know, so all of these women had arranged marriages, and I asked them, would you get arranged marriages for children, and do you think that's a good idea, what do you think? And actually most of them said, I did get arranged marriage for at least my first or second child, but then actually, and a lot of them told sort of stories about like, yeah, my son actually wasn't that happy, my daughter, you know, like, didn't have a great time, and so actually then I turned my mind against them and I decided not to. And I think for kind of third generation, when I asked about grandchildren, they were just like, oh, you know, hopefully they'll just find someone. And so I think like there's also like what as generations go, I think there's less of a need to enforce certain norms because new norms are created all the time and like contexts are changing. Yeah, it's not a very coherent answer, but I think I'm not 100%.
So you were talking about how the women's role is changing in relation to the men's masculinity.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering if when they were talking about themselves, if they talked about how their own masculinity or femininity was changing, or like whether... So I'm like thinking about this in Bangla, right? And how like people would talk about like, oh, if you start doing certain things, then people would be like, That's boys' stuff,
yeah.
Or like that's men's work.
Yeah,
so like I'm wondering if
thinking. Yeah, I'm just trying to recall. I think so. There was a definite kind of like where women had done a lot of work, they would kind of kind of balance it out by saying, oh, but you know, like I did all the housework. And kind of I think to me that was like a kind of re-emphasizing, no, but like my femininity, my role as a mother, as a housekeeper, was still central. I think I'd probably have to go through the transcripts, but I'm sure like, in my opinion, it was less of like, you know, that's like man's work, and more like, it was like a class concern, and it was like, well, if I go and do that job, you know, I'm going to be deemed like it's going to reflect badly on my husband and me, but also it's like, oh, the fact I'm working suggests we're poor. That's really embarrassing. That's kind of what I picked up. But yeah, I'd probably like to consider that more.
I was thinking that since you mentioned that one of these women who talked about the occupational work they did back in Pakistan included weaving, which is by occupation associated with Julahas and Saris. And and these are occupational intermediate castes, not exactly the lowest of the lot, and with significant numerical majority have also politically mobilized themselves, so not to make a generalization that they didn't have any power at all. But I was thinking just in terms of the caste question, she was, like your grandmother was asked, are you going to clean toilets?
Yeah.
I was thinking if in terms of carrying forward notion of respectability, not in terms of like a religious moral discourse, but coming in from the biradari, taking up ideas of an elite Sharif man.
Mm-hmm.
So to think that back in Pakistan, and this happened post-partition also, that a lot of people who came across the border erased their caste identity in the fact that to not acknowledge it means to not be restricted to it repeatedly. So I was thinking that now that you have moved away from that that specific regional and social context, you are not Julahas, you are not meat shop owners, are not Qureshis anymore, hence not lower caste anymore. And so coming here, you would also try to imitate the upper caste as much as possible, despite knowing that that's not your position. So do you think that also happened because the caste question became so complicated, like this was the opportunity to imitate what the upper caste did, and like you've already pointed out, it's impossible, you need that kind of economic capital to do so.
That's really helpful to know. Like I definitely feel like my knowledge in terms of like caste context in Pakistan, it was lacking when I did this, but Yeah, that's interesting you raise that, because I did read a lot about how men, particularly when they first came, would kind of, and I think as well as part of the whole, like, this doesn't quite count, and because no one knows you, at least at first, you can do whatever job you want to do. And like you say, like, being a bus driver isn't really the same as being whatever you were before, but what then seems to happen was that, you know, your brother's cousin comes, and actually he knows what you were in Pakistan and what your family were. And actually, I think there is a sense to which, like, there's this kind of, like, it does come back in a way, and, you know, I think, I don't know how much, I'm not sure, like, I wouldn't be able to say personally, like, how much people were imitating upper caste kind of norms, but I think actually what happens, I was reading something about bus drivers in particular, and how actually then caste gets applied to new jobs, so, like, bus driving becomes, a particular caste becomes associated with that here, which is really interesting. And I don't know, like, I don't know, like, enough about it to say, but I know, for instance, as well, like, you know, women who would just be like, what caste, what, I don't know what you're talking about, and it's like, because they're kind of like, yeah, you're trying to leave behind and, like, trying to pretend, but as soon as other people know you, yeah, and I wonder as well, like, how much that has to do with the kind of fear about going back and kind of saying what you're doing there, because, and a lot of men, you know, if they said, well, yeah, I'm just working in a foundry at night, when really, like, that's not at all who I was back home, is interesting, but yeah, that's, I didn't know that about the weaving and the spinning, but that's a really interesting thing. And I think as well, like, it's then how caste and class interplay, because when you come here, like, a lot of these people are working class, but on the other hand, a lot of them aren't, like, not a lot, but, like, a minority aren't, and, like, a couple of the women that I interviewed, two of them had come from Karachi, they'd gone to university, they had a very different initial experience in that they moved immediately into big houses with kind of, like, an extended family immediately. And there was, like, one of them had, like, a family business, and it was, like, a big, like, they had multiple kind of stores around Bradford and Leeds. And so I think, yeah, class and then caste, I would be interested to know more about how they intersect. But yeah, I think in some ways the caste thing just was able to reassert itself in a different way. But then there's the whole thing, like, the idea that, like, there's no caste in Islam, and then I think people trying to, like, younger generations trying to suggest that to older generations, and there being this discrepancy in the fact that, well, if your brother already knows what past your uncle is, how are you going to pretend that doesn't exist, that kind of thing. But I don't know if other people have thoughts on that, because I don't know too much.
One last question, is alright. I'm the son of one of these women that you're talking about, and they first arrived in Bradford with my father-in-law, first talking about, but actually moved from the Shire, from Yorkshire to Lancashire. Right? So I was quite curious if there's any sort of difference between the Shires and whether you'd actually, and I missed the first half.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know 100%. I mean, what kind of, do you know what kind of work people were doing there? Because I know, like, the reason people came to Bradford and Leeds was because this textile manufacturing business, like, business was huge, and, like, they needed labourers. I don't know enough about Lancashire to know what was going on there. I think actually that's interesting because, like, not from what I know, like, settlement patterns don't seem to change that much over, like, two or three generations. You know, like, the furthest, I don't know, like, my mum moved from Bradford to Leeds. You know, like, it's not. But then, I don't know, maybe that's generalisation, because I do know people who have, yeah, I don't know. I don't know enough about Lancashire.
So you mentioned that the women that you interviewed often wouldn't refer to themselves as being discriminated against, but based on you listening to them, you reached the conclusion that they were. Similarly, I suppose, I mean, just speak about my mother or my dad, I can't ever imagine them referring to themselves as being empowered, being feminist. I guess what I'm trying to ask is, when there's a disconnect between the language that the researcher uses and the language that the subject uses to describe themselves, to what extent do you think you might be imposing a narrative onto these individuals?
Yeah, definitely.
And how do you seek to get around that?
Yeah, so yeah, this is something that I confronted, like, almost immediately, because A, the interviews weren't in English, like, none of them were in English. So firstly, I was doing an active translation into English, which in itself, you know, misses certain nuances, misses certain things that were going on. And then I did a second active translation into, like, academic language, right? Into vocabulary that suggests certain things. So I think this is something that I grapple with, and I do, you know, there was an extent of kind of like, just on a personal level, I felt kind of sad, like, is there a way that I can, you know, present their experiences without kind of trying to prove anything about them? And I think the way that I tried to do that was to quote heavily from the women in my dissertation, the transcripts I've made available. But I definitely agree, and I think that's why, so when I would discuss something like discrimination, what I would try and do is say, like, the way that I phrased the question meant they answered it in a certain way. I'm not suggesting, like, it's really hard to balance, but like, yeah, so my kind of, the way I work it in the dissertation is to be like, you know, that is how they understood it, but how I'm understanding discrimination is also different to how they're understanding it, and how my context of growing up in this country is also different to their context of coming to this country. And ultimately, I think, like, it is like a language barrier in two senses. And, you know, there's the sense as well that, like, I'm quite personally, like, entwined in these stories, and, you know, in a way, like, I probably have my own biases and my own things of, like, the story that I wanted to tell.
Sure. So, like, if I follow up, so when did you tell the people that you're interviewing how you subjectively interpreted their stories and the narratives which you wish to tell based on those interviews they've given you? And what was their response to how you wish to present their stories?
Mm-hmm. So the active interview, the process of interview, I obviously interviewed them at the start, like, I didn't have any idea of what I wanted to say. And then, I mean, this poses a really sad question for me, which is that actually most of the women that I interviewed wouldn't be able to read my dissertation. So I could tell them, and so, like, for instance, like, I've talked to my grandma about, like, you know, this is what I wrote, but I think it really is, like, it's a double language question. It's like, what does it even mean for me to say to her, you know, your wage responsibilities are really important and they contradict the statistics that we have in the archive? Like, what does that mean to her? I mean, what is it? And the reason it means something to me is because those mainstream narratives exist, it was like, I felt like nobody was saying, here's another narrative from these women. But on the other hand, I do have, and I think it's a problem of academia, it's a problem of institutions, is that, like, there isn't a way for, ideally, I would have said, here's the pen, you write your story, it will be academically validated in the same way as all the previous scholarship that's come, and it will be taken to be like a balancing narrative. But because that's not the case, like, yeah, I think I don't think there's a, like, really I can't answer that question because linguistically there's not a way that I've been able to say, hey, look, I mean, the two women who were educated have asked for copies of the dissertation, so, like, they will engage with it, but it's like, I just think, like, it's such a, I don't know, do you see what I'm saying? Like, it's such a big,
I completely,
like,
agree. I mean, I can't see how you could have asked that more honestly.
Yeah.
You did. I guess the only thing is that I would be very, very hesitant personally to use phrases like empowered or feminist to describe the actions.
I didn't.
No, I'm talking about generally.
Alright, yeah. I deliberately didn't use those phrases because,
like,
they're very politically charged.
Yeah, exactly. And if you're avoiding using those kind of charged languages, you try to be as authentic as you can.
Oh yeah, no, like, those key phrases that I did not want to use. And also I think it's like, I never wanted to suggest that because women have agency, they're feminists in the sense that, like, this country has understood that to mean. You know, instead I kind of, and that's why I say, like, I quote from them a lot, because I'd be instead saying, look, she's suggesting that she was able to divorce her husband because she got this wage. She needed to divorce him, he wasn't great. I don't know what that means. I don't impose a meaning on that. So that's what I try to do.
Yeah. Last question.
Did you find that the Ripley people very much appeared as, like, one homogenous group? Or did you find sort of, like, regional variation, sort of depending on, was their land flooded? Did they have to come because of that? Or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, so I did spend, like, the first section of the interview talking about, like, where did you come from, what was it like? I did talk about, like, the Mangla experience in particular and the dam, but experiences were not homogenous at all. Like, there was such varied, kind of, like, you know, almost to the extent that you were like, all of these people were completely different, because one woman was like, she was like, yeah, like, my husband just got a job, and the next day he was like, we have to go, and that was nothing to do with the dam, like, that was completely irrelevant. And then, you know, there were women who came in the 70s, and that's a completely different reason. I think, like, overall there was no homogeneity, but, like, I would have to like, look at the Peripheral Women's accounts next to each other, but like from the top of my head, like definitely not. And actually, none of the ones I interviewed actually came because of the Mung Wadam, which is interesting because that's like such a big factor, like you say. I hadn't really thought about that.
Thank you.